church on this fourth Sunday after the Epiphany. Whoever you are, and wherever you find yourself on your journey of faith, you are welcome here. Blessed be God, most holy, glorious, and undivided Trinity. And blessed be God's reign, now and forever. Amen. God be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you govern all things both in heaven and on earth. Mercifully hear the supplications of your people, and in our time, grant us your peace through Jesus Christ our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit. One God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from Deuteronomy. Moses said, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You shall heed such a prophet. This is what you requested of the Lord your God in Horeb on the day of the assembly when you said, 'If I hear the voice of the Lord my God anymore, or ever again see this great fire, I will die.' And the Lord replied to me, 'They are right in what they have said. I will raise up for them a prophet, like you, from among your own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet, who shall speak to them everything that I command. Anyone who does not heed the words that the prophet shall speak in my name, I myself will hold accountable. But any prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, or who presumes to speak in my name a word that I have not commanded the prophet to speak, that prophet shall die.'" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus and his disciples went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. And he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent, and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. the gospel of our Savior.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. In the name of our loving, liberating, and life-giving God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. In the 1990s, before I was a priest, I went to a smallish Episcopal parish in Honolulu. It was called the Church of the Epiphany. And certainly, I had a number of epiphanies while I was there. But little did I know how many future realizations it was setting into motion. These were the years just before I went to seminary. So I was trying to learn as much as I could about the way the church worked. I had a full-time job which claimed 50 or 60 hours of work a week. Yet in addition to worship, I was part of a Bible study group, went to vestry meetings, had consultations with the rector, and was the volunteer editor of the parish newsletter. I thought I knew a lot about the ongoings at the church. So when the rector told me that he would write an article for the newsletter, and it ended up taking him 2 weeks to get it done, I could not understand. I thought to myself, what in the world is he doing? As I look back on my confident judgment now, in many respects, I feel ashamed of myself. I made some allowances, but pretty much I thought I had everything about parish life figured out. I can't even quantify how much I've learned since then. And I realize what a process life has been and will continue to be with God's help. Thankfully, the things we know and our breadth of experience is ever expanding, allowing us to develop new ways of thinking and seeing the world as we grow. Deuteronomy, an ancient book of the Old Testament, probably written 600 or 700 years before the birth of Christ, describes such a process taking place. The Hebrew people had come to feel that they could no longer stand up to seeing God in the pillar of fire and on the mountain. They shied away, whether out of their own unworthiness, fear, or guilt, or because of God's overwhelming power. And they asked for an intermediary. God heard their request and agreed to changing the way things were being done. A prophet was appointed to speak for God to the people. He would be faithful to God and to the words he was given to speak. This is one of the many times in Holy Scripture when we can see an example of the way things are being done evolving into something else. Sometimes for the good, and sometimes not. In the 18th chapter of Genesis, remember, Abraham bargains with God over the fate of the city of Sodom, in case righteous men are found there. Abraham first asks God to spare the city for the sake of 50 righteous. But by the end of the negotiation, God agrees to spare the city, even if 10 righteous men are found. In the New Testament, we remember the Syrophoenician woman who was able to bargain with Jesus. As the story begins, she asks Jesus to heal her daughter of demon possession. Jesus responds by saying, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs," which is generally interpreted as a put-down because of her Gentile status. The woman counters Jesus with her own argument. "Sir, even the dogs eat the children's crumbs, the things that fall under the master's table." And Jesus responds positively, telling her, "Because you have said this, the demon has gone out of your daughter." The woman's response seems to turn the tide and move Jesus to heal her daughter. We learn from this that people do grow and change, and in fact, it is part of living. This illustrates a kind of thinking known as process theology. It is a theological approach that understands ultimate reality in terms of a dynamic process of becoming and ongoing change. Existence is understood in terms of the mutual interaction of entities through which change occurs. God is understood to participate in development through intercourse with the changing world. And God's power to create change in the world is persuasive rather than coercive. In this framework, neither mistakes nor missteps have to be seen negatively, but as part of the larger process. Another thing that makes great sense to me in this scenario is the power of prayer and the opportunity we have to participate in the creative process. When we pray, we are asking God to come alongside us in life, to guide, call, forgive, heal, reconcile, and bless. We barely need a reminder of our places in the ongoing processes of dealing with the virus at home and around the world. The process of learning, being self-reflective, praying, and finding willingness to make justice available to all. Life is a process. It is a process for us to figure out the best ways to share God's love while we take special precautions because of the coronavirus. It's a process for us to get things straight with the diocese about our annual meeting, which, by the way, is now scheduled to be online on Zoom, Sunday morning, February 14th. And it is a process for us to come into a Sabbath year. Our gospel reading has something to teach us about process as well. As is common in the gospel, we have the story of Jesus in the process of doing something: healing, teaching, blessing, or praying. In today's case, he is casting out a demon. Demons can haunt us in the form of unforgiven guilt, irrational anxiety and fear, even in unforgettable memories and unhealed psyches. The demon Jesus casts out in today's reading is rendered silent and cast out of its host. All who see it take place ask, "What is this? A new teaching with authority?" He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. And what would we say about what this story has to show us about process theology? This shows might have been critiquing in what was the current Jewish culture, that the scribes and the priests were no longer asking questions about what God wanted to be done, but they were simply giving answers, as if the answers had already been determined forever, as if there was a period on the sentence. What gives Jesus authority is that he knows God is different than that. And people heard it in his voice and knew it in his teaching. The great philosopher Thomas Aquinas had a very memorable way of describing this to us about God. He said, "We cannot think, we will not be right to think of God and form our lives thinking about God as the answer. We will live rightly when we think about God as the question and let the question form our lives. We must constantly be responding to what is the current moment and what God would have us do." Jesus was constantly presented with new situations, even on the Sabbath. And his response was always love and always compassion. Let us be in the process of sharing love and compassion in a time where everything is changing, except the love of God. Amen. Please stand, and with me, affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him
attention and to cast out fear in our midst, for the turmoil of congregations, for the healing of human frailty and divisions among the followers of Christ Jesus. Hear us, O God.
For your mercy is great.
For world leaders and the nations under their authority, for those who have great wealth and the many who do not, for those who have power and those who keenly feel their lack of it, for those who have destructive weapons and for those who have none, hear us, O God.
For your mercy is great.
For those who are victims of others' idolatry, for all who labor or suffer as a result of the coronavirus, for children who cry for food and shelter, for parents who cannot answer the needs of their family, for peacemakers, volunteers, and those who give through charities, and for those who advance the greater good and seek justice for all, hear us, O God.
For your mercy is great.
For all who are in pain and in need of care, for those who are dying and the people who love and care for them, and especially for those we name now, aloud or silently.
For Marge, for Derek,
hear us, O God, for your
mercy is great.
For the wisdom to seek the question of God, for the changes in our lives, keep us mindful that answers are not in ourselves alone. For the ability to give thanks for the people who have brought us to this time, our ancestors, teachers, pastors, and the martyrs of every age. Hear us, O God.
For your mercy is great.
Into your hands, we commend all those for whom we pray and for those we easily forget. We ask you for blessing. We ask your blessing on all your people, that we may come at last to the truth of welcome around your banquet table that has no end. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
On you, forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you, Mary. Peace be with you. Please be seated. Once again, welcome to worship with us at St. James Church. Some of you may have tuned in this morning expecting to have an annual meeting, and it has been delayed until February 14th, two more weeks. And our plan for that day is that worship will be provided at the Washington National Cathedral that morning, and that our congregation will gather on Zoom for Zoom meeting of the annual meeting at 10:45 on Sunday morning. We will be making the Zoom link available in the E-Tower and elsewhere on the Friday before the meeting, and we will be attempting to provide you with some very simple instructions you can follow to come on to the Zoom meeting and be a part of the proceedings. Many people have felt intimidated thus far about getting on the computer and joining a Zoom meeting. Let me tell you that if in this process of being shut down by the coronavirus, you have been able to do email, you will be able to get on a Zoom meeting. The most important thing is a good internet connection. So look for that information to come and plan to be with us for our annual meeting on Valentine's Day, February 14th. We will continue offering distribution of Holy Communion every third Sunday in the parking lot, and you are invited to join us each month for that, as long as we are still in the practice of offering services online in order to protect ourselves from the coronavirus. Do not let idols grow and multiply in your hearts or in your minds, but give of yourselves your time and your possessions out of love for this creation and honor for what we have been given. Amen.
Amen.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
turned against you and betrayed your trust. And we turned against